Hello everybody. Today's presentation covers electron configurations and all things related to electrons. This is extremely important in the field of chemistry because the number and position of electrons in the atoms of different elements are going to determine their chemical properties. The periodic table is divided into four blocks, and these are very important for understanding electron configuration. The four blocks are the S block, P block, D block, and F block. As we look at the next slide, we'll have you label your individual periodic table also. This image shows the different blocks of the periodic table. The four blocks again are the S block, the D block, the P block, and the F block. Please note that helium located here is considered to be part of the S block. To help you remember the different blocks of the periodic table, try this mnemonic device. This portion of the periodic table looks like a mountain, so we'll call this the summit for the S block. This other region, the P block, looks like another mountain, so we'll refer to this as the peak. This area of the periodic table looks like a valley, D for Death Valley. And then finally, the F block down here looks like a train track, so we can think of the freight train that would roll along the train tracks. Take a moment to label your individual copy of the periodic table. Just to the left of hydrogen, you should label 1s. Just to the left of lithium, 2s. Just to the left of sodium, 3s. And so on for the S block. Just to the left of scandium, please label 3d. Just to the left of yttrium, y, label 4d. Just to the left of boron, label 2p. And just to the left of aluminum, label 3p. Just to the left of lanthanum, which is right here, please label 4f. And just to the left of actinium, label 5f. So what do S, P, and D, and F mean? Well, these are referring to different sublevels that exist within a principal quantum level. This is referring to an energy level. So if we're looking at the first energy level, n is equal to 1, there's only one sublevel. It is an S sublevel. For the second energy level in atoms, there are two sublevels. Now we would have an S and a P sublevel being possible. In the third energy level, there are now three sublevels, S, P, and D. And in the fourth energy level, there would be S, P, D, and F sublevels present. This slide shows a Bohr model of a neon atom. Please note that the nucleus would contain 10 protons and 10 neutrons. In the first energy level, principal energy level 1, there would be 2 electrons, and these would be found in an S sublevel. In the second energy level, there would be held a total of 8 electrons. 2 of them would be in the S sublevel. The remaining 6 would be in the P sublevel of the second energy level. This slide shows what the different sublevels, S and P sublevels, would look like. The 1s orbital is also the 1s sublevel. This is a spherical region of space which surrounds the nucleus of an atom where we have a high probability of finding 2 electrons. The 2s orbital or 2s sublevel is again a spherical region of space now further out from the nucleus, which would be a tiny dot in the very center of this image. In the 2p sublevel actually contains 3 different orbitals. The individual p orbitals look like 2 balloons tied together. We see 1 p orbital here, we see another one illustrated here, and we see another one illustrated here. These are going to line up along the 3 axes, x, y, and z. This slide details the number of electrons which can be held in different orbitals or different sublevels. The S sublevel can hold a total of 2 electrons. P sublevels can hold a total of 6 electrons because there are 3 orbitals, each which can hold 2 electrons. The D sublevel with 5 orbitals could hold up to 10 electrons, and the F sublevel with 7 orbitals could hold as many as 14 electrons. Please note the first energy level with only an S sublevel can hold only 2 electrons. The second energy level contains both S and P sublevels, so it can hold a total of 8 electrons, 2 plus 6. The third energy level with S, P, and D sublevels can hold a maximum of 18 electrons because it contains an S sublevel, a p sublevel, and a d sublevel. The fourth energy level could hold up to 32 electrons. This slide shows the appearance of s, p, d, and f sublevels. For GT chemistry, you should be most familiar with s sublevels and p sublevels. To determine the electron configuration of arsenic, an element that contains 33 electrons, please reference your periodic table. This is going to be as easy as counting from 1 to 33. Start with element number 1. That's hydrogen. You've labeled that on your periodic table 1s. So we're going to count 1s and then 1s2. Now we're at number 3, which is lithium. So that's 2s. So we're going to count 2s1, 2s2. Now we've counted up through number 4. Next to number 5, boron is labeled 2p. So we need 2p6. And we'll continue this up through number 33. So we get 3s2, 3p6, 4s2, 3d10, 4p3. The first number in an electron configuration is telling us the energy level which different electrons are found in. These two electrons are in the first energy level. These 10 electrons are going to be located in the third energy level. Additionally, the third energy level contains 6 electrons in the p subshell and 2 electrons in the s subshell. The letter is telling us which block or which sublevel are the electrons located in. The superscript is going to tell us the total number of electrons in that particular orbital or subshell type. For example, in the fourth energy level, the p sublevel contains only 3 electrons, so it is half filled. The diagonal diagram is a good way to remind yourself which different orbital types or sublevels will fill in which particular order. First filled is 1s, followed by 2s, followed by 2p, then 3s, then 3p, 4s, after that 3d, followed by 4p, then 5s, then 4d, 5p, 6s, 4f, 5d, 6p, 7s, 5f, 6d, 7p. The noble gas configuration is a shortcut way to write electron configurations. GT chemistry students will need to know how to do both the full version and the shortcut version of electron configurations. Please note that the noble gases are going to be found in the rightmost column on your periodic table. They are helium, neon, argon, krypton, xenon, and radon. Also note that each noble gas finishes a row or an energy level. This means that the highest energy level in all of the noble gases is going to be 100% filled. Noble gas electron configurations are going to take advantage of this by condensing what we need to write in order to convey information about the electrons that an atom has. For example, the electron configuration of helium would be 1s2. The full version for carbon would be 1s2, 2s2, 2p2. The noble gas shortcut for carbon would be to write helium rather than the 1s2 and then to fill in the information that comes after that. Now, for this particular element, the shortcut does not save us a lot of writing. Let's take a look at an example where it does save us quite a bit of time. Earlier, we determined the electron configuration of arsenic, which is found right here, 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p6, 4s2, 3d10, 4p3. Notice that the part that's in yellow is going to be the exact same as what the electron configuration for argon would be. So to write the noble gas configuration for arsenic, we would fill in, for this information, AR in square brackets, followed by the information that's in purple, 4s2, 3d10, 4p3. So this can save us quite a bit of writing as we're writing electron configurations. The Aufbau principle tells us the order in which different orbitals will be filled by electrons as we build atoms. Now please note that each electron is going to occupy the lowest energy level first. This is because, well, essentially electrons are lazy. So if we have an atom that has only one electron, that electron would go into the 1s orbital. With two electrons, both can go into the 1s orbital. An atom that has three electrons would place two in the 1s and one electron in the 2s. Four electrons would place 2 in 1s, 2 in 2s. If we have to go beyond that, we would place one electron into the 2p sublevel, into one of the 3p orbitals. And as you see, we're going to fill up through 2p, and then into 3s, and then to 3p, and then to 4s. And you should note that the order that these orbitals are being listed here does correspond exactly with the diagonal diagram. What is this referring to, saying that these are all equivalent energy? It means that the three orbitals here, the three boxes that are part of the 2p sublevel, are all of equivalent energy. The three orbitals, the three boxes that are part of the 3p sublevel, are all equal energy. The same goes for the five different orbitals that are part of the 3d or 4d or any of the d sublevels, and same goes for the seven orbitals which make up either of the f sublevels. The Pauli exclusion principle tells us about the behavior of electrons within a single orbital. These electrons are going to have what we call opposite spins. In chemistry, we call them spin up and spin down. I like to think of tops, however, one spinning clockwise, the other one spinning counterclockwise. In this illustration, the box is representing an orbital. The up arrow is representing one electron with an up spin, the down arrow representing a second electron with a down spin. Hund's rule, this tells us that single electrons with the same spin must occupy each equal energy orbital before additional electrons with opposite spins can occupy the same orbitals. What the heck does this mean? It means that this is not an okay way to write an orbital notation for nitrogen. This one is. Why is this the case? I like to think of these three boxes right here as being like seats on the bus. And because people are not necessarily always friendly on a city bus, for example, if there's an open available seat, people are going to fill into an empty seat before two people will sit next to each other. Hund's rule tells us that the orbital boxes for orbital notations should always be written following this pattern. With one, just a single up arrow. Two, we go up, up. Three would be up, up, up. Four, we would be up, 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 and then a single down. Five would be the three ups and then two downs. And then six, three ups first and then three downs following. This is an orbital notation for the element V, vanadium. What we can see here is that we have different energy levels, energy level one, level two, level two, level three, level three, level four, and also, again, level three. We also have different types of subshells, S sublevels, P sublevels, D sublevels. Orbitals are single boxes. Application of the Aufbau principle, Pauli exclusion principle, and Hund's rule allows us to number the electrons, and this is important for determining quantum numbers. So let's number the electrons. Here we go. Number one is the up, number two is the down. Three up, four down. Here's 5 is the up, 6 is the up, 7 is the up, 8, 9, 10 are the downs, 11 up, 12 down, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23. This slide shows examples of Lewis structures for the elements of period 2. Please note that a Lewis structure tracks only the number of electrons in the highest energy level. We call these valence electrons. Lithium has one valence electron, beryllium 2, boron 3, carbon has 4, nitrogen 5, oxygen 6, fluorine 7, and neon 8. Now, as we look down the columns for these different elements, everything that's in the same column as neon will have 8 valence electrons with the exception of helium. All of the halogens underneath fluorine will have 7 valence electrons. All the members of the oxygen's family or group will have 6 valence electrons, and the same goes for the other columns as well. Please review this information about quantum numbers. We will have a class period dedicated to students writing orbital notations and using that information to determine the quantum numbers for any given electron. This final slide relates electron configurations and orbital diagrams with information previously learned about ions. Please remember that ions are charged particles, and ions can have either positive charges or negative charges. Positively charged ions will lose a number of electrons, which is equivalent to the number of valence electrons they possess. Lithium would have one valence electron as an atom. It would have an electron configuration of 1s2, 2s1. When it loses that one electron in the second energy level, it drops to having a full first level, and this stabilizes the particle and causes it to have a positive one charge. Negatively charged ions will gain electrons to stabilize those particles. The chlorine atom gains a single electron moving from 3p5 to 3p6 to become stable. Sulfur will add 2 electrons to completely fill its 3p level to become completely filled and stabilize the particle.